Have you had an encounter with the King of the Forest? If so, drop me a line at contact@buckeyebigfoot.com and tell me all about it. Then I'll share it with everyone. Welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot. Hello there, everyone. Now, I know you've got some good snackage lined up for tonight. I know you all know the drill by now, and I think you're going to need it. Because tonight's encounter, no, it's not an encounter. Tonight's memoir, I think you're really going to enjoy. I just want to say real quick to all of you speech and grammar Nazis out there, suck it up, buttercup. Take a few trazodones. Do whatever you got to do to get through this. Because guess what? I didn't change a thing that Donna Lynn wrote. And you will know by her speech patterns, she's a country girl. So, get that snackage going, because we're getting started right now. Hi, Buckeye Bigfoot. I've seen Bigfoot several times when I was young. I wanted to tell you about some of that. I'm almost 70 now. I was growing up in the 1950s and 1960s in West Virginia. And back then, I had heard of mountain devils, as they were called. Now, you can say that this happened outside of Logan, West Virginia, in Logan County. That's as specific as I can get because I still have a big pack of family all living around there. Now, I've been told many times that the mountain devils were the reason that we had sometimes livestock go missing, and sometimes we had damage to the barn or from the doors, and the reason that much of our produce went missing from the garden or the back porch where we put it. Now, mountain devils were also the reason that my mother insisted that some of my dolls went missing because I left them outside on the porch one day. I don't know if that's true, but those dolls were never seen again. But mostly, I had always been told that anything you left outside was going to walk away on big hairy legs. I didn't understand what that meant the first time I heard it. Then I got told the mountain devils like to take things, and that those things are how they walked away on big hairy legs. Just the name mountain devil scared me when I was a kid. I was picturing a red devil with horns and a pitchfork, like you saw in books back then. I said something like that one day, and then I was told, no, not like that at all. These mountain devils are tall, wide, and really hairy, and that our particular variety around there smelled really bad. I don't recall that, but that's what everyone said. As long as I can remember, we would be told that we had to be in by dark, and mostly we didn't argue with that. We had heard all kinds of things in the night, really weird screams and sounds. And as kids, we didn't want to be out there once that sun went down. It just didn't seem right to us. But as long as Daddy was there in the house, we all felt safe. But then came that day, the day that Daddy wasn't there anymore. A heart attack came and took him away while he was working one afternoon. And never again did Daddy come up the driveway beeping his horn to let us all know he was home. I think the mountain devils figured it out pretty fast that Daddy was gone, because that's when they started coming in real close to the house all the time, and they had never done that before. They would come up to our porch and take things right off the back porch. You could hear them. Once we heard them pushing on the back door. You could hear it rattling because the door was loose and the glass was loose in the back door window, so you could hear it rattle. We laid there with Mama in our little house in the dark of her bedroom, all huddled together as we listened. At that moment, I didn't know what was out there was a mountain devil. I thought that it was a man at first, that someone had come out to do us harm, because even back then you heard about that. People would break in, and they didn't even bring their own things to hurt you. They would get your kitchen knives out of your kitchen, and that's what they stabbed you with. So that's what I was afraid of. But Mama got up and told us to hush, and we all followed her to the kitchen. Mama had Daddy's gun. She went towards the back door, and she told us all to stay right there at the doorway on the other side of the kitchen. Mama went to move the curtain on the back door with the end of the shotgun, and as she did so, the end of the gun touched the glass. Now, we had taken the leaving the porch lights on all night because we were getting to be afraid, but that didn't bother those mountain devils any. They still came in close. And when that curtain moved and the gun tapped the glass, it looked up, and we kids all saw what was out there on that porch on the other side of the glass. I don't think that mountain devil was one of the really big ones, unless it was hunkered down, but I don't think it was. And it might have been a young one, since it fit up under the porch roof. But right there, on the other side of that door, on the other side of that thin piece of glass, stood a big, hairy mountain devil, mean and ugly looking. It had dark brown hair all over it. I remember that the hair looked shiny right under the back porch light. The face was all lit up from the porch light, too. I could see it had a wide face. It was mostly a smooth face with only some hair that looked like a beard on a man, and in the same areas as a beard. But that wasn't a man or a human's face under there. I could see that even from the other side of the kitchen. The eyes were hard to see. They were set far back in the head, and the light didn't seem to touch them. But I did see glinting from them in the porch light a few times when it turned its head. I also saw its teeth. When Mama moved that curtain, it jerked its head and looked right up at us, and it opened its mouth and showed its teeth, and its mouth opened and closed real quick a couple times, like it was chewing or gnashing on something. This all happened all at once, and we all started screaming. When we did, the mountain devil looked a little past Mama right at us. I remember exactly when it stopped looking at her and started looking at us. Scared me to death. And it didn't matter that we was all back there in the darkness. It could see us. I know it saw us. I thought Mama was going to shoot it, and I was waiting for the bang. But then the mountain devil just walked off the back porch. It was just gone. Mama backed away closer to us kids, and we was all scared, including her. Now, we didn't have a phone in the house back then. I know that's hard to imagine today, but back then, not every house had a phone. It was a bit of a luxury, really, especially in our rural area. And money never flowed like water, even when Daddy was alive. And after Daddy was gone, the flow of money had dried up like a desert riverbed. So there was no phone. There was no calling anyone. We had to sit tight, and that's what we did, and we sat all together until morning. Then Mama put us all in the car, and we drove on down to go get one of her brothers, who then called one of her other brothers. They was all hunters in her family, and good ones in the county from what I heard tell. So those two came out, and one of them brought his whole pack of hunting dogs. And they spent the whole day roaming all over. I don't know what they saw, if anything. When they came back, they told all of us kids to stay in the house as much as possible and not to argue. And we didn't. Then they pulled Mama outside to the gravel driveway, and they stood there and talked. They was out of hearing range from us kids. We don't know what was said, but I could see Mama's face, and it didn't look good. So Mama told us from then on that we were going to stay close, and we did, and we didn't argue, like I said. And she watched us and everything around like a hawk. She also quickly started selling off most of our livestock that week. When we asked, she said we couldn't keep up with them now that Papa was gone. Now, that didn't make sense to me or any of the other kids, since Papa had been gone most days working anyway, and the livestock care mostly fell to us and Mama. So nothing had changed there. And as far as cost for their feed, first, they earned it back if we sent them to slaughter, but even still, we grew most of the feed for them. So that wasn't the issue either. But somehow, we knew better than to question further, so we didn't. And I was just 12 years old, and while not a baby in the family, I wasn't anyone with any say about anything in that house. so now we had no livestock. We made sure we didn't leave nothing outside that could be of interest to them. But like my doll, sometimes the strangest things we didn't even think about would be of interest to them. We thought we had taken everything in, and all that was left out there were the rocking chairs. Now, Mama and Daddy used to sit out there on the front porch in the mornings on the weekends because it faced north, so it was always shady and cool. The front porch of the house rose up quite a bit from the ground since it was set on a slight slope. Down below us was the road, and further down the way was the bottom of the valley. So we had a really nice lookout view from up there. But those mountain devils, apparently at least one of them was interested in a rocking chair. I don't know why exactly. Now, Mama and Daddy's bedroom was on the front left side of the house, and we had big windows that opened right up onto the front porch. Our house was a much older house, and the windows were tall and narrow, and you could open them from either the top or the bottom. So, you could pull the top window down part way and leave the bottom window closed. Now, that was helpful on summer nights. You would get a good cross breeze in from a lot of the windows open that way in the house, but you were mostly secure because the bottom stayed closed. I should also add, there weren't any screens in those windows either. So that's how we took to sleeping, and that first summer after Daddy was gone, we took to sleeping with Mama in that room. We were all over on the floor and a couple of us in the bed. None of us wanted to be spread apart in the house all alone at night. Mama would have liked to have moved house, I think, but we had no money and we had nowhere to go. It was just a bad situation all around at that time. Poor Mama. She did try to do the best for us that she could. Don't be thinking otherwise, please. So we're all sleeping in there. Top part of the window was pulled down a foot or so because it was real hot. There's no screens on the window, and it was hot and humid, and I don't think any of us were sleeping well. We were all so miserable. I think that's when I heard the squeaking of wood, and I wasn't the only one that heard it. Every head in that bedroom, except the baby of the family, who was only 3 and could sleep through a bull charging through the house, every one of us lifted our heads right up off the pillow to listen. We knew what we heard was right outside that window, and that sound was the very familiar sound of the rocking chair moving. Then we heard it scraping on the wood floor, like something was pulling the rocking chair off the porch. Mama got up, and she got Daddy's gun that had been leaning in the corner by the dresser. I heard her open it to check the shells, then I heard it snap shut again. Sure. It could have just been some dummy out there trying to steal themselves a rocking chair. But who the heck would bother to steal a beat-up old wooden rocking chair out there in the wilds of West Virginia? Nobody, that's who. And I don't think that the Mountain Devil was stealing that chair either. I think it just wanted to move it out from in front of the window, because it knew that's where we was. The porch light was on out there, so when the window suddenly got dark, we all knew something was in front of the window. Just then, my middle sister Tammy kind of did a half scream. We could all see this shape out there, sort of crouched down, and it was looking in at us through the lace curtain gap. At the same time, its hand was going up the glass window, and then it came through the opening at the top. Its hand was just waving inside the house at us like it was looking for something to grab or touch, but it was so high up, none of us were in danger. But it was still the strangest thing ever to see or have to say. Then we're all screaming when we saw that. And now this mountain devil pulls its hand right back, then it starts screaming right back at us full force. Felt like a freight train whistle in my ears, it was so loud. But it didn't sound like a train whistle. It was a scream more like a big cat screeching. It was terrible. I don't know how else to tell you. Now I did expect Mama to shoot it, but she didn't. Sometime after all this happened, Mama said that she had a hard time thinking about shooting it. She wasn't a hunter, and she had never shot or killed nothing before. She couldn't even take a hatchet to one of the chicken heads. But she said that she had already decided that if it ever tried to come in the house, or if it tried to hurt one of us kids, that was the line she had drawn, and that's when she was going to shoot it. And she hoped that she would never have to. But at that moment, that night, we had all been screaming, and then it was screaming something terrible right back at us. And strangely, that shut all of us kids right up. I mean, every one of us kids went silent when that thing started screaming at us. I know it don't make no sense, but you can be scared silent. And we was. It could have come right through that glass window if it wanted. And I believe that it knew that. I also think it saw Mama there with the gun. And I don't care what nobody says. Those things do know what a gun is. I just know it. The only times it would back off or leave us alone was when it saw that gun. Until it saw that gun, every time, it would just try to be scarier and scarier and meaner to us. But it sees the gun, it takes off. It knows what a gun is. Now you tell me what that says about it. After that, there was another night that we laid there, and we listened to the rocking chair, and it just creaked and creaked out there like somebody was sitting in it. I don't know what it got out of watching it or of pushing the rocking chair. I don't know, but when it happened again, Mama took both her and Daddy's old rocking chairs the next day and put them out on a big fire in the yard. It was sad to see it happen, but that was the end of that. No more creaking on the front porch to wake us up at night. One day, we were walking home from the bus stop that was at the end of the road below our house. That's when we saw it watching us. I've never been so scared. We were all scared to death, and we started running as fast as we could for the house, screaming our heads the whole way. It had been standing by the line of trees that went into the woods that went into our neighbor's land on that side. I wasn't the one to see it at first. My brother Bobby saw it. I think it was the same one that had been on the back porch. It was about as high as that one that night. It looked meaner and scarier in the daylight, though. And when it showed its teeth to us again, and we heard a growling sound, we took off. I think I heard thumping on the dirt, like it was coming after us. I didn't stop, and I didn't look back. We were screaming, and Mama heard us, and she came running out on the porch to meet us, and she had the shotgun in her hands. As soon as we were parallel to her and running up the steps, she was running down the steps out into the yard, and we heard the shotgun being fired twice out there. When she came in the house, we asked her, did she get it? Did she shoot it? She said no, but she saw it had ducked back into the tree line long before we ever got near the porch, and she didn't think she came anywhere close to hitting it. It was pretty far away. And that's when we had the whole conversation about her not really wanting to shoot at anything, and she had a line that if it came after us kids, she'd do her best to kill it. Well, that day, it came after us kids. So while she didn't hit it, she wanted that thing to know that she meant business, because we all had already agreed before this that it knew what a gun was. Plus, it now had come after us during the day. It was getting bold, and we had never had anything happen like that during the day. Everything had always happened at night. Mama said it was time to put some fear back into that thing. She called the uncles back out again when she next went into town, and one of them stayed with us, sleeping on the couch for the better part of a week. And just like when Daddy was there, it did not come up none too close to the house, and it didn't cause any of the same kinds of trouble. But the minute he left, I want you to know, that mountain devil started its games all over again that very same night. I forgot to tell you earlier on that lots of nights while all this was going on, even if that mountain devil wasn't up by the house, and even if we didn't see it, we would know it was out there, because we would start to hear those weird screams and noises out there in the woods. and everyone said that those were the mountain devils. We knew it because if we heard them at night, everyone else up and down that valley and holler did too, and that's all they talked about amongst themselves. So when our uncle left that night, the weird screaming started, and it was close up against the house again. Then came the rocks on the roof, and we had had that before, another thing I forgot to tell you. But we could lay there, and we would hear them hit the roof, and we could follow the sound in the darkness with our eyes as the rocks would roll off one side or the other of the roof. And let me tell you, when you have an old metal roof, that sound is very loud. I also know that mountain devils like potatoes. I know because it kept pulling up entire plants right out of the ground. It knew the potatoes were there. And here's the thing I want you to know. I want you to know that these mountain devils are smart. They watch. They learn. The potatoes are how I know it. We'd grown potatoes for years, and they had never been bothered by the mountain devils. Until one day, we were all out there lifting potatoes, and we saw it crouched down on the hillside above the house, just watching us. It was late afternoon. We didn't want to stay out there anymore. We got scared, ran into the house, left our pitchfork, left the wheelbarrow, left everything out there. Mama got her gun, and we walked right out there, got the pitchfork, got everything we had left, and brought it in the house. From then on, we only worked the garden. If Mama or one of the older ones was out there watching over us with the shotgun. But here's the thing. The thing is that very night, after all that happened, that is when the potato plants started getting pulled up. See, we knew it liked potatoes because we once left a bucket of them on the back porch. The whole bucket disappeared, and sometime later, we found it empty away from the house. So it had ate all of them potatoes. Now it saw where they came from, and it knew how to get them now. So don't you trust those creatures. I've read some comments on this channel and others how people think they're peaceful and we should be kind to them and don't be afraid of them. People act like these things would make a great yard pet. You're all wrong. Those things are smart and they learn quickly. Do not trust them. That's all I'm saying. I could probably tell you 100 more weird things that happened, or something about the times that we laid there and listened to them scream at night. And I could probably tell you 12 more times I saw with my own eyes one of those mountain devils. But it's all mostly the same. I saw them. Usually there was a staring contest or a standoff. They would bare their teeth, maybe growl, maybe scream, maybe throw something, and then they would take off. I don't know what the point of all of it was, but they kept doing it. I also saw that some of them were really big, so it wasn't just the smaller one that came to the kitchen door that night. The big ones, though, they were scarier in a very different way. The smaller one was really aggressive, showed its teeth and growled and screamed at us and everything. The bigger ones, I never saw them do that. But it was the way they would look at me that scared me even more. I don't know how best to say it. They weren't mean-looking like the smaller one. It was the way they looked at me. It was like they were distant and cold. There was no emotion, not at all like the smaller one who was always angry. I don't know why that scared me even more. My best thing to tell you is like this. It's like they were farmers and I was the livestock. They had no feeling or emotion about me at all. That probably doesn't sound quite right, but I'm having a hard time with it. There was just something cold, but very intelligent in their looks. Put the two together, that's mighty scary, and it scared me way more than that smaller one. Okay, I'm sorry, I've typed lots here, but even now when I think back on all that happened during that time, more and more keeps coming back to me. I know reading it, it's probably just a jumbled mess of back and forth. I'm sorry, I ain't no fancy writer. I'm telling you what I remember. But things were so bad for us for a while that one of my mother's brothers stayed there on and off most of that summer with us. And he also saw and heard a lot of things. Enough that he, our grandparents, and another uncle all pitched in to help Mama and us get out of there and move. None of them felt safe with us staying there. They had seen and heard enough to think it was a problem for a lone woman and a passel of kids to be out there. And I think they were right. Now, it's been a long time, but I still remember the fear of that year. And I've been asked, why didn't we call somebody about all this? Why didn't we tell somebody? Well, just who the heck were we supposed to call or tell? There wasn't anybody to call or tell at that time. We didn't even know anything about what they really were. Sure, tell somebody now and everybody would say, oh yeah, that's a Bigfoot or one of them Sasquatches. But we didn't know them as anything other than mountain devils at the time, and everybody just dealt with them in that area. So why call someone? We all knew about it. That's all I'm saying. So thank you. I hope that this makes some kind of sense and isn't as bad off as I think it is. I really think this is a turd of an email, and I hope you can do something with it. I hope you can say the whole thing on your channel, turd and all. But people need to know and understand that these things watch and they learn. So be careful what you let them see you do out there, because they just might figure out how to load and use a gun. I'm not kidding. They definitely know what one is, and they're afraid of them. Thanks, Donna Lynn. Wow, thank you, Donna, for sending in your mini-memoir, and that's what I call it. Turd and all. I don't think it was a turd at all, personally, but... And I'm betting most of the listeners out there enjoyed it, too. I'm sure they're all going to let you know about it in the comments below. You know, I've heard many times that people have said that they are intelligent creatures, more so than we give them credit for being. I find it interesting, too, because you're not the first person I've heard say... They seem to know what a gun is, at least some of them. Thankfully, everyone got through that time unharmed. All right, well, that's it for tonight, Sasquad. You know we'll all be meeting up again real soon, so don't be sad. And until we do meet up again, always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening, everyone. If you like what you've heard and want to hear more, hit the like and subscribe button. And don't forget the bell to get notifications.